Good morning. Welcome to Prince of Peace. My name is Pastor Alex. It's good to be in the church with you today. Today is kind of the New Year's Eve of church. This is Christ the King Sunday. This is the last Sunday in the church year, which means that we are going to be switching over from all of our gospel readings being in Luke to the Gospel of Matthew. More importantly, it's Christ the King Sunday, which means we celebrate Christ as a king, Christ as a savior, Christ as a servant, and we look at some readings that point out what does it mean to be a church of Christ. As we begin our service today, I want to invite a young man forward named Grant Solswich, who's with us. He's going to start coming up. While he's doing that, go ahead and start coming up. While he's doing that, I just am excited to point out that we are a church, part of a greater church. And so one of the things that we do is we have opportunities to serve all over the world. Some of you know that I served as a missionary for a little while. Some of you have been on trips to Tanzania. Some of you have been at schools that are Lutheran colleges and things like that. So there's a million different ways that our church reaches out past this little wall. And the gift that Grant has is he's going to talk to us a little bit today about what that reach looks like, especially out of the Northern Great Lakes Synod. So we welcome Grant.
Thank you so very much. And I don't know if you were able to get the overhead slide or not.
We gave some handouts.
Pardon me?
We have some handouts.
Oh, you have it as a handout. That's cool. Well, some of you may remember me. First thing I'm supposed to do is introduce myself, and you did a marvelous job. And you may remember me from before your arrival when I was substituting in here for you on pulpit supply. So, yes, I'm Grant Solswich. I'm a member of Messiah Lutheran Church. By the way, I'm one of 20,000 baptized members of the Northern Great Lakes Synod. That's a lot of people. We represent 79 congregations in the UP in northern Wisconsin. And I'm here on behalf of Bishop Finnegan to send you a word of thanks. It's been a tough couple of years for our congregations as we needed to adapt to many aspects of our ministries because of the pandemic and other issues. This congregation has been an amazing resiliency and generous in your supporting of the local congregation and the ministries that go beyond your walls. People have shown their generosity and support for things that really matter. And so the thanks for not giving up in the midst of other challenges. You're still here and doing God's work by your generous acts of faith. So, Bishop Finnegan says, I want to say thanks to this congregation, Prince of Peace, for your generous support of Christ's work in our world through the ministries of this congregation, the Northern Great Lakes Synod, and the wider work of Christ Church through the ELCA, the largest Lutheran denomination in the United States. Care to guess how many congregations make up the ELCA? 8,900, with 3.1 million baptized members. Again, that's a lot of Lutherans. So, she wants to thank you for your gifts, and I thank you on behalf of the wider church. Last year, your mission support funneled to the Great Lakes Synod. Now, this is last year before you arrived. $8,724.16. Bishop Finnegan and Assistant to the Bishop Deering also send greetings and their appreciation for your partnership in ministry. We're working together for the sake of God's mission to love the whole world. Well, what has the Northern Great Lakes Synod been doing with your money and your time and talent? In 2021, a net of almost 48% of your undesignated mission support dollars known as benevolences, was passed on to the Northern Great Lakes Synod to the ELCA. One example of the work is the Lutheran Disaster Response. Between 2019 and 2021, Lutheran Disaster Response International provided more than $14.4 million in humanitarian assistance to support responses to natural disasters and other humanitarian concerns. And almost every time you see a disaster on TV, your church, as part of the ELCA, is there somehow doing God's work, our hands. That's the tagline. A large percentage of the ELCA national budget goes to support world hunger relief, their efforts through the global mission. ELCA World Hunger Support for International Relief and Development Projects exceeded $41 million during the pandemic. And during the pandemic, the ELCA gave $500 COVID domestic grants for hunger. And I don't know if you received one or not. But totaling $1.5 million. You can proudly say that your congregation's offerings to 2021 helped support 240 ELCA missionaries in 40 countries throughout the world. And even during the pandemic, new and innovative ministries were started in the United States by the ELCA. Having national church-wide organization gives our 8,900 congregations the power to pool their resources and service to others. On a more regional and local level, your mission support gifts are used to support campus ministries at Michigan Tech, Northern Michigan University, Badenoch, and also Finlandia. Your mission support dollars and other designated gifts to the Synod are used for formation of classes and for the adults, stewardship trainings, congregational leader trainings, congregational vitality retreats, and Synod staffing, of course. Many of our Synod congregations are in transition, and your Bishop, Catherine Finnegan, and Bishop of Assistant Jim Deering are there to help these congregations, and I think you've been a benefactor of that. I want to refer to a booklet that your congregation received. I believe you have that. I don't know how many copies you have, but I know that should be enough for leadership and maybe to pass around with the congregation. They tell stories. They tell stories of what congregations are doing within this Northern Great Lakes Synod. I happened to get the newsletter yesterday, and I saw that you continue to help disaster relief, Lutheran Rural Relief, campus ministry. I mean, all of these things were listed. And so I know kind of what you're doing. I know that from my own experiences, and some of you have helped out with that. 17 years ago, my wife and I started what we call our jam ministry. And I know you've participated because you bought the jam. And that first year, we made our jam and everything. I was like, oh, what are we going to do with all this jam? And so we gave it all to the church, and the church sold it. I think it was for $4 a jar then. And that's 17 years ago. It's now only $5 a jar, except for thimbleberry. But that caught on because the proceeds went to helping the pastors, what was known as a pastor's discretionary fund, that now has changed over the years to the community assistant fund. We're partnering with St. Vincent de Paul, the Salvation Army, and some of the others to provide assistance in the way of providing money for rent, food, gas for people's cars so they can get to work, or medical appointments, helping with medical bills. That's all in response to not only JAM, but our Giving Tuesday on the 29th of this month. So it's been tens of thousands of dollars that have gone back into the community. And I'm proud to say, gee, we kind of helped with that, and we still do. Because I know that although we've gotten older and we don't produce quite as much JAM as we used to, but it's still somewhere around the vicinity of $1,800 that comes from JAM sales alone. So I thank you, and I thank you for your support, and I know you continue to buy our JAM. So I just wanted to let you know there's congregations out there that are doing good work just as you are doing, and we thank every one of them. And so I want to stick around afterwards, visit with you, as I have in the past. I'll leave whatever materials I have, a couple of those books, and that tell the story. I want to encourage council leaders and your committees to use it. May give you some ideas. This booklet has a vast array of stories. So thank you again for allowing me to visit with you and tell you about the important work that you're doing. And so I'd like to read a small scripture lesson, reading from Philippians. Every time you cross my mind, I break out in exclamations of thanks to God. Each exclamation is a trigger to prayer. I find myself praying for you with a glad heart. I am pleased that you have continued on this with us, believing and proclaiming God's message from the day you heard it right up to the present. So let us pray together. Dear God, I thank you for the generous and appreciative hearts of your people gathered here today in this congregation. As we share our time and our financial resources, may we come to truly understand that we are blessed to be a blessing to others. Bless the labors of this congregation and their partnership with the Northern Great Lakes Synod, the ELCA. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Grant. I'm going to encourage you to talk with them after the service, or you can ask a lot of people that have done some of these trips or have participated in a million ways. Obviously, you know about some of the things we do, whether it be hosting for the dog sled race or the Fall Bazaar, which just raised $3,000 to go to Salvation Army, and all the other things that we do. So we're very active, and so we're thankful for Grant reminding us that we're not doing this alone. We continue with our call to worship as we do some prayers. We just continue to pray for Mark, who had a surgery and is just healing at home. We pray Mark Vancouvering. We also pray for Jeanette Miller, who had a little fall, sprained her ankle. And so we ask for prayers for that. And, of course, the Vernon family, as we have the family, the funeral for Dennis later today. With all those things, though, we continue with our call to worship. Jesus, remember me. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who redeems us in Christ Jesus, whose steadfast love endures forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you and our neighbors. We have ignored voices that call for justice. We have neglected actions that witness to your righteousness. We have spoken and acted in ways that disrupt your beloved community. We truly repent of things we have done and left undone. For the sake of Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Restore our troubled spirits so that we may live in newness. Follow the way of the Spirit and build up the body of Christ. Amen. Rejoice and be glad. God hears the prayers of all who cry out and restores us to life through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Therefore, I declare to you the forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Continue with our gathering hymn, Crown Him with Many Crowns, verses 1, 4, and 5. Invite any children forward for the children's message. So today I want to talk to you about kings and queens. Kings and queens. What do you know about kings and queens?
They get protected and they wear crowns.
They get protected and they wear crowns. Perfect. Anything else? What do we know about kings? Are they powerful? Queens, are they powerful? No. Kind of, yeah. They're pretty strong usually. Are they popular? Yeah, they're real popular. We kind of know about everything they do. If a king does something, it seems like it's always reported. We know about the queen. Even the queen all the way over in England, they tell us what happens with the royal family, things like that. You said kings and queens, they wear crowns, right? And you have a pretty good idea of what that looks like? I want to show you a crown. I want to see if this looks like what you think about.
This is a crown that we talk about every year around Good Friday. Does this look like a crown you'd want to wear? Does this look like a crown you'd want to wear? Does this even look like a crown you'd want to touch? Yeah, even I'm a little terrified right now. This is what we call a crown of thorns. A crown of thorns. I'm going to put it away for a second. The reason that we talk about a crown of thorns is because a long time ago, there was this man named Jesus. We call him the Son of God, and we will read about him as a baby, and we hear about him doing all these miracles, and then we hear about this story where he dies on a cross. When he died on the cross, they said that he was wearing a crown of thorns. They were using it to mock him. They thought he wasn't very kingly. But what we know about Jesus is that not only does he die on the cross, but he raises from the dead. And when he raises from the dead, the thing that he wanted everyone to know is that we're loved no matter what. Because we aren't always acting like kings and queens or princes and princes. Sometimes we fight with our siblings. Sometimes we don't always listen to our teachers. Sometimes we don't do the right thing. We don't act like we're kings or queens. But Jesus reminds us with his love that we are always part of God's family. That God always loves us, even when we're great and even when we're not doing so great. So, whenever you see this crown of thorns, which is usually around Easter time, I want you to remember that the crown of thorns doesn't make us sad because we didn't have to wear it. The crown of thorns reminds us just how far God would go to show his love for us. So, can you say a prayer with me? Dear God, we give thanks for crowns. The crown of thorns that shows us love. Help us to love others as you loved us first. Amen. Now, because you are princes and princesses in the house of God, I want to make sure I give you some royal gifts in the form of candy. So come on up and grab one, and you can go back to your seats. Just one. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. We continue by singing the Canticle of Praise.
Let us pray together. O God, our true life, to serve you is freedom, and to know you is unending joy. We worship you, we glorify you, we give thanks to you for your great glory. Abide with us, reign in us, and make this world into a fit habitation for your divine majesty. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We continue with the first reading.
First reading comes from Jeremiah chapter 23. Woe to the shepherds who destroy and scatter the sheep of my pasture, says the Lord. Therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the shepherds who shepherded my people. It is you who have scattered my flock and have driven them away, and you have not attended to them. So I will attend to you for your evil doings, where I have driven them and where I will bring them back to their fold, and they shall be fruitful and multiply. I will raise up shepherds over them who will shepherd them, and they shall not fear any longer or be dismayed, nor shall any be missing, says the Lord. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will raise up for David a righteous branch, and he shall reign as king and deal wisely, and shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In his days Judah will be saved, and Israel will live in safety. And this is the name by which he will be called: the Lord is our righteousness. The word of the Lord. Our psalm is Psalm 46. We'll read it responsively. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Though its waters rage and foam, and though the mountains tremble with its tumult,
there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High.
God is in the midst of the city, it shall not be shaken. God shall help it at the break of day.
The nations rage and the kingdoms shake. God speaks and the earth melts away.
The Lord hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Come now, regard the works of the Lord, what desolations God has brought upon the earth.
Behold the one who makes war to cease in all the world, who breaks the bow and shatters the spear and burns the shields with fire. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold. Our second reading comes from Colossians, chapter 1, 11 through 20. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from the glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, while joyfully giving thanks to the Father, who has enabled you to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. For in him all things in heaven and on earth were created, things visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or powers. All things have been created through him and for him. He himself is before all things, and in him all things hold together. He is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, so that he might come to have first place in everything. For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him God was blessed to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth earth or in heaven, by making peace through the blood of his cross. The word of our Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please stay comfortable for our gospel.
The Holy Gospel comes to us from St. Luke, the 23rd chapter, starting with the 33rd verse.
Glory to you, Lord.
When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. And the people stood by watching, but the leaders scoffed at him, saying, "He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one." The soldiers also mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, "If you are the King of the Jews, save yourself." There was also an inscription over him, "This is the King of the Jews." One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God? Since you are under the same sentence of condemnation, and we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. I think it's interesting, Christ the King Sunday comes every year, and it always causes me to look backwards, not just as we look backwards in our church year, but also in the year that is coming to a close as we get ready for Thanksgiving and Christmas and, of course, the new year. Obviously, this year is one of those times where we look backwards and what do we see? But actually, the death of Queen Elizabeth, one of the most noted leaders throughout our history, one who has lived through many presidents, who's lived through many different commanders, and yet it's this year that we will look back and remember this is the year that she passed. And at the same time, I was thinking about kings and queens, and I started to think about a place that I spent a little bit of time, and that's a small country called Eswatini, or formerly Swaziland. It's one of the last remaining places in the world on the African continent that has a true king, King Mswati III. And in my time, the king has been somebody that has been praised, but also has been condemned. And it depends on the day and the action, but the king is very much favored and unfavored at the same time. And if you ask around the countries in Africa, especially ones like Kenya or South Africa, where they remember their battles and fights with the country of England, they too, when they hear about the death of a queen, say, "We are sorry for her loss, but we also remember everything that she stands for." So when we think of kings and queens, it's easy to think about royalty and jewels and exceptional clothing, but we can also be thinking about what does that king or queen or leader stand for? And if it's for a short time, when we think about presidents, we think about what has happened under each of our presidents, or maybe you work for a company and you remember what happened under each of your bosses, or even as you moved through grade to grade, what happened under each teacher, while one might be considered favorable and others a dictator. But what we do with that is what we choose to do. Because today on Christ the King Sunday, we're lifting up this idea that Jesus is a king. And yet there it sits before us, the crown of thorns. an image of death, an image of pain, an image of nothingness. For the person who wears that crown seems quite powerless and unable to actually execute any form of power, any look of royalty. And yet this is the Sunday where we read about Jesus on that cross going to his death. And this is what we read when we proclaim that Christ is the King. But why? Well, because actions, they do speak louder than words. And the greatest leaders in all our life are the ones that we remember what they truly did and not just what they said. For it's not the best player sometimes that's remembered at the end of a great game, but it's the one who is sitting there amongst their teammates, pushing them and urging them on to further greatness. I have a story that I hate to tell because it involves the Chicago Cubs, but I'll tell it to you today. There's this story about the Chicago Cubs when they won the World Series, and they were coming in to this locker room, and it was a rain delay of Game 7. They had just given up this massive home run, and all their heads were down, and it seemed like nothing mattered, and that curse that everyone was talking about was showing itself one more time, as it looked like the Cleveland Indians would be the ones who were going to be champions. And then the right fielder came into the locker room, an old veteran, I forget his name, but he gave this rousing speech about, we remember who we are, not just at our low points, but at our best, and everything we've been doing, the highs and the lows, it comes to right now and how you want to exist in the game for the next little bit that we have left to play. And the reins seemed to almost miraculous lift, allowing the game to be finished. And what happened? But the Cubs went out and they won. And the city celebrated. And I remember seeing grown men with tears in their eyes and children dancing in the street through all hours of the night. You could hear it throughout the city, even in the suburbs where I lived. It was a great moment. But so many people give credit to that one little bit of leadership from a person who had not been the star for the last year, who hadn't really produced the way that they had hoped, but yet it's his speech, it's his words, it's his leadership, his selflessness to be somebody who said, I can't always be the best, but I can urge the best out of each and every one of you. So he did, and they succeeded. But even if they didn't, what he provided them with was an image that no matter what happens next, our job is to leave everything out there. And that's what I see in our gospel, is Jesus sitting on that cross showing us that this is the extent of what God's love looks like. God's love doesn't cower in the face of Pontius Pilate. It doesn't cower in the face of mobs of people and soldiers mocking Jesus to his very core, saying, are you really the King of the Jews? Then show yourself. Are you really a king? Then show yourself. If you're so strong, get off this cross and make us believe. And yet, Jesus isn't trying to make believers out of fear or power in a sense of lauding it over his followers, but rather Jesus is trying to make followers by showing this is the example. And what's so great is in this moment where it seems everybody is yelling at Jesus and it seems like nobody seems to get it, there's one person, a thief, sitting on the cross next to Jesus, that finally has had enough of hearing his fellow criminal just go after Jesus again and again and again. And it's that thief that says, aren't you sick of yelling at somebody who doesn't deserve it? We deserve it. We're criminals. I know why we're on this cross. And then he looks at Jesus and he just says, Jesus, remember me. And we were talking about this in Bible study, like, do the criminals really know Jesus? And we think that, yeah, of course, because he was quite a popular name, and they would have known at least a little bit about who this Jesus was. But also at the same time, these criminals, they know that they have no right to ask anything of anyone. And yet this is where Jesus responds. Jesus doesn't respond to, "Are you the king?" Jesus doesn't respond to, "Save yourself and show us you're a creator." Jesus remains silent through all of the hurtful words. But when one single criminal says, "I just want you to remember me," that's where Jesus lifts his head and says, "Today you will be with me in paradise." This is where Jesus chooses to use his power, is to give one criminal in his last bit of breath hope so that he might know who God truly is. That's the gift that we're given today, is that we are given that same gift to use our life for God's purpose. And it doesn't mean that we won't have our moments of failure and falter. But what it does mean is that the same promise that Jesus makes to that criminal on the cross is the same promise Jesus makes to each and every one of us, so that we might feel that freedom to give that joy to others. And what does it mean to give joy to each other? A long time ago, someone said, being a Christian is all about joy. It's about Jesus, it's about others, it's about you. It's like a little Christian YMCA. J-O-Y. But Jesus, others, you. If you live your life in that order, what you start to find is that when you look to Jesus, Jesus will point you to others, and you'll find this satisfaction within yourself, because you'll know that you're doing God's will. And we are so blessed to have Grant tell us the story, some which we know, some maybe that we haven't heard, about what our church is able to do. And we have had so many things in this last year that we can look back on and see our selflessness and see where we've taken that joy and put it into action, looking at Jesus and allowing ourselves to look for the others. And it'll continue into the new year. And it'll continue into today when we get to lift up one of our own in Dennis Vertanen and say, "Well done, good and faithful servant." And we get to remind ourselves and Dennis's family and Dennis that today he's with our Savior in heaven, in paradise. The promise is not an easy life, and the promise of Christ the King is not the royalty of this earth. But it's about the heavenly gains, the heavenly inheritance, to know that we are God's children, and that gives us a special ability to walk with confidence where others might want to make jokes. We can stay silent because we know who we are and whose we are. So in this blessing, we go forward as the family of Christ, knowing God and knowing what God is doing with us. Amen. Amen. We continue with our hymn of the day, "Beautiful Savior."
confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
United with your saints across time and place, we pray for our shared world. We pray for your church, emboldened denominations and faith-based organizations to creative and collaborative ministries and increase our work for the sake of the gospel. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the earth. Protect waterways from pollution and animal habitats from destruction, especially Lake Superior and Chocolate River. Guide us carefully in stewardship of waters, plant life, and animals. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for the nations of the world. Instill in every leader's heart a desire for justice and peace. Support the work of international collaborations that seek the goals and health and joy for all people. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity, especially Mike and Sylvia Cooper, Louise Bickerman, Marjorie Small, Betty Johnson, Brittany St. Pierre, Ann Petro, Suzu, Alyssa Porter, Colin, Gail Johnson, Sharon Clark, Jay Barrett, Bev Goodell, Cassie, the family and friends of Dennis Vertanen, Jerry Jarvis's family, and those we name aloud or silently in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. We pray for this assembly. Guide our pastor and our council members in discernment and nurture new leaders with fresh ideas. Give this congregation a spirit of discipleship and service. Lord, in your mercy. We give thanks for all who have died in the faith, especially Dennis Vertanen. Console us who mourn and comfort us with the beautiful promise of life in your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Accept these prayers, gracious God, and those known only to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share that peace. Continue with our offering prayer. We pray together. Blessed are you, maker of all things, as you have entrusted us with all that you have created. Now gather our gifts. Nourish us with this sacrament, and send us to those who hunger and thirst, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death in the grave and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. All are welcome here.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. day when my strength is failing, the end draws near, and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I'll worship your holy name. Worship your holy name. Worship your holy
now may this body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in life everlasting. Let us pray together. Blessed are you, maker of all things. As you have entrusted us with all that you have created, now gather our gifts, nourish us with this sacrament, and send us to those who hunger and thirst for the sake of Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. As we look forward in the week ahead, this is an interesting week because we have Thanksgiving coming, so the offices will be closed Thursday and Friday. After this, we have fellowship, and you're all invited to come downstairs for that. There'll be an opportunity to get your picture taken. If you've seen, our photo board is slowly growing. We encourage you to take pictures. You don't have to be a member. Just if you want to be somebody that's part of this community and you want people to hopefully better learn your name and your face, this is a true gift for newer pastors and newer members. But it's also a great way to just show this family here at Prince of Peace. So I invite you to get your photo taken today. We'll have other opportunities, but they will start to become once in a while, whereas the last couple weeks it's been every Sunday. So we thank Larry for making that available. Also, if you haven't yet turned in your time and talent sheet or your pledges for the coming year, you might have an envelope like this or need an envelope like this. You can come and talk to me. Again, it's just a way for us to plan about what's coming in the next year and a way to reach out for those who maybe need or want to get more involved. This is one way to see all the things that we do in a piece of paper. Again, if you need these things from me, just please talk to me and I'll make sure you get them right away. And if you have those and you want to turn them in, you can put them in Carol's box, like on her door, or you can just slide it under the door of her office. Going forward this Tuesday, we have a Thanksgiving service, a service of coming together with Holy Communion, and then we'll have a little pie fellowship afterwards. So Thanksgiving is not a religious holiday, but it's an opportunity to just, again, say thank you for all the gifts that we have. And so I invite you to that at 6 p.m. this Tuesday. Also, then next week starts Advent, so we will have our Advent wreath out. The colors will be blue, and we'll have those 4 weeks of Advent in preparation for Christmas. Any other announcements that I need to be made aware of? I believe we have a gift for the free store. So, Larry, can you come and collect this gift on behalf of the free store right now? One of you? It's coming. Here it is. You can just set it here, and we'll help Larry get it to wherever it needs to go. But we have the free store just down the road, an opportunity to serve our community, and the Girl Scouts have been doing some work in the last couple years. And so this is one way that we can give back. Again, one of those little things that we do to be the big hand of God in this church and in this community. So on behalf of our Girl Scouts to the free store, we give you these gifts of Crest toothpaste and floss and toothbrushes. So. Yeah, so when you run out of money, first thing you usually cut is dental work. Excellent. Excellent. Again, the service today is at 2 o'clock, visitation starting at 1. In lieu of flowers, the family's asked for gifts of non-perishable food items to go to the Salvation Army. If you can be here, otherwise, please do say a prayer for Dennis and his family. So with this, I want to give you this benediction. May God give you grace never to sell yourself short, to risk something big for something good, to remember that the world is too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. The blessing of God, Creator, Christ, and Comforter be with you now and forever. Amen. We continue with our sending song, As You Go On Your Way.
Blessing in the world.